morning, students. See, the discussion of yesterday's class, flocculation or coagulation of the salts. See, I told you, gets coagulated due to so many reasons. One of electrolyte. How an electrolyte coagulate a salt? This question arises. For that I told you the way it gets coagulated. For example, this diagram indicates arsenic sulfide salt, where the charge of the sulfide ion, adsorbed sulfide ion, is neutralized by the oppositely charged ion from the electrolyte. And what that ion is called? So, when the charge gets neutralized, the smaller salt particles of 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer cannot stay in the dispersion medium. They start aggregating or rejoining, and that is starts precipitation, settling to the bottom. Okay, now I told you how to judge the ability of the electrolytes, capacity of the electrolytes, or I will use a word, precipitation power. What power? Precipitation power, how do you use? Who is more powerful? For that, I told you two important things. What? One is flocculation value. The number of millimoles of the electrolyte per decimeter cube of the salt, required in minimum concentration to coagulate the salt. If you use maximum, so here what I said, lesser the flocculation value, higher is the precipitation. Simultaneously, there is a rule. What is that rule? Hardy and Schultz rule. So this is also one more question. And it says, greater the valency of the active ion of the electrolyte, higher is its precipitation power on a salt. Is that right? Greater the valency of active electrolyte, higher is its precipitation power on a salt. So for that I have given you an example. We shall coagulate the arsenic sulfide salt by these three electrolytes. Sodium chloride, magnesium chloride and aluminium chloride. Since it is an electronegative salt, the ion responsible for coagulation is Na plus Mg2 plus Am3 plus. And when you see the flocculation value, this is lowest. And then it tallies with what? This. Now suppose greater than Mg2 plus greater than Na plus. Correct, now? Suppose if the question is asked which electrolyte order, AlCl3 greater than MgCl2 greater than NaCl, and the flocculation value is opposite. So here one more example also we can give. For example, coagulation of ferric hydroxide salt. Thrice Fe3 plus salt. For example, ferric hydroxide is an electrolyte, is a salt. We are having a ferric ion adsorbed over the surface. And when ferric ion is adsorbed over the surface, what is the charge of this colloid? It's an electropositive salt. Now some electrolytes like K2SO4, KCl, K4FeCl6 complex. Tell me, what are the active ions? Here Cl minus, SO4 2 minus, Fe CN6 4 minus. Again, greater the valence of the active ion, higher is the precipitation power. Here the valence is 4. Now suppose if I use chloride ion, this chloride ion is responsible for precipitation. Means of potassium sulfate, then it is better. So this diagram is what? Coagulation of ferric hydroxide solid. Now flocculation value, can you tell me which one, what is the order of flocculation value or what is the precipitation power order? What is the order of precipitation power? FeCN6 4 minus greater SO4 2 minus greater than Cl minus. Okay, so I think you have understood what is flocculation value. Lesser the flocculation value, higher is the precipitation power. And what is Hardy and Sully's rule? With the examples, you can note this also. So yesterday while concluding the class, I told you one word, that is electrokinetic potential. Electrokinetic potential or zeta potential. Zeta potential. Understand? Zeta potential or electrokinetic potential is what? Okay. Look at this. During the coagulation of the solid, there is a fixed layer of the charge, which is the adsorbed layer. And there accumulates the mobile layer of opposite charge. During coagulation, there is a fixed layer of, which is fixed adsorbed layer of charge, which is originated in the solid. And from the electrolyte, when oppositely charged ions, which is mobile, free, there develops a potential difference. The difference of potential between the fixed adsorbed layer of charge and the oppositely charged ion from the electrolyte, mobile layer of the electrolyte, is zeta potential or electrokinetic potential. What is that? That this difference of potential. Here, there is a fixed layer of sulfide ion and there is a mobile layer of sodium ion. The difference of potential between these two layers. One more question. What is zeta potential? The difference of potential between a fixed adsorbed layer of charge and a mobile layer of opposite charge, right? Opposite charge from the electrolyte. From the electrolyte during coagulation of a solid is called zeta potential or electrokinetic potential. So that also exists. See, why, you know, raining is also like that, because of the two oppositely charged clouds colliding with one another and coagulation of the clouds. When clouds coagulates only, artificial raining is also same. Clouds are having very high stability. They don't coagulate. If the clouds doesn't coagulate, clouds is what? Water dispersed in air. If clouds doesn't coagulate, no raining. Artificial rain, how do they do? They search the clouds through jet or aeroplane. And from there, what they do? They spray some electrolyte coagulating agent, silver iodide and sand they flow to increase the volume, sand. So they spray so that the large area, some kilometer they spray. Due to this, cloud gets coagulated and clouds are keeping on moving. So if it is artificial raining is harvested in Bhatkal, I think raining may be at Annamar or raining may be at Boindur or at Sagar also. Understand? So, and sometimes if the cloud density with water is less, it will not be much raining. Okay. Suppose if artificial raining is tried to create in Bijapur, there may be less chances because that clouds are having no much water capacity. Okay, this is all about what? So many things I told you. Coagulation of the soil and the related aspects. Is it right? Okay. Last property, maybe 8. Protective action of salt. Protective action of salts and protective colloids. Yes. So as the name itself indicates, which colloid have to be protected? For example, lyophilic salts have long life. They are having affinity towards the solvent. They never coagulate. They are stable. But what about lyophobic salts? Lyophobic salts have short half life. Sorry, short life. So lyophobic salts can be coagulated easily. Now I want to increase the life of lyophobic salt by preventing its coagulation. Then what to do? I need some protective colloids. Then what are those protective colloids? Starch is a protective colloid. It is a macromolecular colloid and it is a lyophilic colloid. Gum is a protective colloid. Gelatin is a protective colloid. Protective colloid, gelatin. In fact, gelatin is the best protective colloid. Similarly, ecgalbumin is also a protective colloid. See, definition I will tell you. What is a protective colloid? A lyophilic colloid which can prevent coagulation of the lyophobic colloids by the previous addition of it to the lyophobic colloids is a protective colloid. After coagulation you should not add. After the mix getting spoiled you should not add. After milk getting spoiled, if you add, it will not be regained. Before the coagulation only, proportionate amount of lyophilic colloid you have to add. Like that it is. Milk is not a salt, it is an emulsion. It's a colloid. So what is a protective colloid? A lyophilic colloid. I'll write it here. protective colloid. A lyophilic colloid. Which can prevent coagulation of a lyophobic colloid. How? By the previous addition of it to the lyophobic colloid is a protective colloid. What is protective action of cells? This phenomenon of protecting the lyophobic colloids is, this phenomenon is protective action of cells. Give some examples for protective colloids. Star, gum, gelatin, etc. So for this some testing is there, gold number, they take gold salt as the standard salt. They add some NaCl 10%, NaCl 1 ml 10% NaCl to 10 cubic centimeter gold salt they add. Immediately it coagulates, correct now. Now they start adding starch, gum, gelatin, etc. Then they have noticed gelatin is required in very very less number, because gelatin is such a powerful protective colloid. Very very less amount of gelatin is enough, but if you add starch, more amount you add. And that they use the word gold number. So this is beyond your annual exam related study, entrance exam we will teach. Gold number, when I measure, gelatin is 0.001, starch is 25. That is why the best protective colloid ever found is what? Gelatin. Gelatin is a type of gum. Okay, 1 minute. You have all eaten gelatin, because it has to be there definitely in the ice cream. Ice cream, in order to stay as ice cream and not ice plus cream, if gelatin is not added there, what will happen? Ice separate, cream separate. That means after melting, what happens, you see, same thing happens. Water separates, ice in the sense, water separates and cream separates. Like you have to eat the ice cream like biscuit. But you are eating ice cream as ice cream only, mixing colloid. How? Lot of gelatin also you eat. It is a gum, goes to the body, goes outside, nothing will happen. So many of you are, don't think that you are eating ice cream, you are eating lot of gelatin also. In front of the ice cream, definitely think this. Yes. Without gelatin, it is impossible to save the life of ice cream. So gelatin is the best protective colloid. And what is a protective colloid, understood? So give an example for the protective colloid, etc. I think you have understood. This is about that is how you can save the life of lyophobic colloids. Now the last part is some colloids around us and application. Okay, one more discussion is there. Emulsions. What are emulsions? What are emulsions? Can you tell me? See, emulsion is a colloid having both dispersed phase and dispersion medium is liquid. What are emulsions? Emulsions are the colloids having both dispersed phase and dispersion medium is liquid. Remember, emulsions are of two types. One is oil dispersed in the water type. So I will shortly use oil in water, O bar W. While dispersed in water, how do you know, identify, I'll tell you. Other type, water dispersed in the oil. And for this we use water in oil. 1 minute. How do you know which is oil dispersed in water and which is water dispersed in oil? I told you the nature of the colloid is similar to dispersion medium. Milk can be compared with water. Milk is oil dispersed in water. Water is more. But butter is, or cheese, butter and cheese, a cream, where water is less, water dispersed in oil. Oil in water, milk. Vanishing cream, milk, vanishing cream. This is not exact cream. And here, butter, cheese, cream, bakery products, butter is soaked butter. Which is more stable? This is more stable and this is less stable. Butter is more stable than milk, correct na? So water dispersed in oil is more stable emulsion and oil dispersed in water is less stable emulsion. So you can say, understand, milk is having lot of water actually. Fat particles are dispersed. Liquid fat molecules are dispersed in liquid water. Remember, what is milk? Liquid fat molecules are dispersed in liquid water. Or liquid oil and fat, one category. Oil molecules are dispersed in liquid water. But similarly, what is butter is? Liquid water is. Or water is dispersed in liquid fat. Or liquid oil. Correct? What are the two types of emulsion? Milk. Oil dispersed in lot of water. Butter. Lot of fat. Water dispersed in oil. More stable, less stable. Okay. Now, another component I will mention now. Third component is also added. For example, for preparing paints, varnishes, etc., they add a third component, emulsifying agent. Emulsifying agent. Agent or emulsifiers. Emulsifying agent or emulsifiers. See, there is a third component other than dispersed phase and dispersion medium, which can be added to the emulsion. Why? To increase its life. What the emulsifier do? It acts as a film, a thin film between the phase particles and the medium. Emulsifiers acts as a thin film between the phase particles and the medium. For example, if this is the phase particle and this is the medium, it acting as a film, an interfacial film, and does not allow the coagulation. Some examples of emulsifiers are right. Emulsifiers, for example, first category, milk category, oil and water category. Some emulsifiers are proteins. Proteins can be added. Proteins in the sense, you can add egg, white portion of the egg. Gum. Gelatin is also a gum. Natural and synthetic soaps. So this is emulsifiers for what type? Oil in water type. Okay. Then for emulsifiers for water in oil, like butter. And for this, some examples are like this. Heavy metal fatty acids. Fatty acids, long chain carboxylic acid derived from fat, stearic acid. Heavy metal fatty acids, that means not sodium or potassium. Heavy metal fatty acids, metal salts, they act as a emulsifier for butter, etc. Lamp black is a allotropy of carbon. Lamp black is also an emulsifier in the fine powdered form. Long chain alcohol, oral alcohol, etc. Long chain alcohol can also act as what? Emulsifiers. For entrance exams also, you have to separately remember which are emulsifiers for oil in water type and what in oil type. What the emulsifier do? Emulsifiers acts as an interfacial film between dispersed phase and dispersion medium, and stabilizes emulsion and does not allow its coagulation. So what is emulsifying agent? A third component to be added for emulsions to increase the life of emulsion is called emulsifier. So note the things, because they can ask any examples. Give an example for all memory based questions. Give an example for oil dispersed in water emulsion, milk, like this. And then give an example for emulsifier of the type oil dispersed in water, also they can ask. What are emulsions? What are emulsifiers? Like this. Yes, the next part is some of the colloids around us and the application of colloids. See, some of the natural phenomena what we observe, especially during the winter season and of fog formation, mist formation in the Himalayan mountains and all, large amount of mist will fall. And fog here also we observe. So for example, if you go to interior Malnad side, very few distance also, you know, while moving in the road you can't see. Thick fog, white colored. These are all the natural phenomena around us, which are all colloids. And many of our food is a colloid. And food medicines are colloid. For example, ointments are colloids. Colloidal food is always good, especially when someone is ill. For example, milk or some tea is a colloid, milk is a colloid, or any fluids what you eat. Malt is a colloid. Any fluid what you use is a colloid. Colloidal food is easily assimilated in the body rather than hard foods. Understand, colloidal food are easily assimilated rather than fried items and all. See, when someone is ill, normally they require colloidal food. They are easily assimilated and absorbed in the body. And many other natural phenomena is there. One important phenomena I discuss, that is formation of delta. What is delta? Suppose in the rainy season, now this is a river, understand, this is a river and this is a vast sea. So this is a sea and this is a river. During river, during rainy season, river water is a salt, right? Agree? River water is a salt and river water when joins the sea, sea water contains electrolyte. Mainly NaCl. So what happens here? Coagulation of the mud particles takes place. And suppose if sunlight falls on that area, maybe evening time, someone has went for a scenery, sight scene. So it looks very beautiful. Understand? River water with the mud particles is a salt coming and joining the sea. Electrolytes present in the sea water starts coagulating the mud particles. Light falls, scatters the light, appears many times bigger and shining the mud particles you can see. And this is delta. It is a phenomena around us. Delta. This region is delta region and this phenomena is delta. This is delta. Yes, these are the phenomena around us. So, application of colloid, some importance I should tell the last part of this. Application of colloid. Okay, see, one important application of colloid is clarification of drinking water. purification of drinking water. See, during rainy season, well water is a colloid. For many days, if you see, the color is a pale mud color. And normally what to do? People drink this water only during rainy season. You see your well, now it is not very clear. Because of some water from inside the soil always coming with mud particles. Suppose if some amount of potash alum, what is the formula? K2SO4, Al2SO4, thrice 24H2O, this is the formula of potash alum. Suppose if some amount of the alum is added, see, mud water is electronegative salt. Now the active ion K plus Al3 plus coagulates the mud particles and settles to the bottom. Coagulates of the salt. So to the big well, when some amount of potash alum is added, it is an electronegative salt, mud water. Mud water is electronegative salt. And when the aluminium ion and potassium ion from the alum, especially aluminium ion, hardy and sole group, valency 3, they start coagulating the mud particles and it settles to the bottom. See, we have no such problem. We are people of coastal area, we have a lot of water. But you think of the area where there is no rain at all, very less density, rain density. For example, Gulbarga, Bidar or Bijapur, Raichur, where during summer and all, they don't get water. Among that, if they have to drink some water which is not clarified from what they do? So they have to put alum. Then what will happen? The mud particle settles and upper water is clarified from mud particles. It is suitable for drinking purpose. Then all the mud particles start segregating from the mud water and grows bigger, starts settling to the bottom. So what will happen? Upper water is free from mud particles. So you can drink it. So this is one application, clarification of the drinking water. Another application is smoke precipitation. One question when it is asked in chemistry, I am telling you, how pollution from the smoke can be minimized? Smoke is a pollutant, air pollutant, atmospheric pollutant. How pollution from the smoke can be minimized? By smoke precipitation. What is smoke precipitation? Smoke is an aerosol. Correct, no? Smoke is an aerosol. Where solid aerosol, carbon particles is disposed in the air. So that carbon particle you have to coagulate. And remember, smoke from household activities are manageable. I am talking about use smoke from the factories, chimneys of the factories. Just you observe a tiles factory, how much smoke goes. Once a question was asked in the old syllabus. Now this will not be asked for 1 mark and all. This is the application. 2 mark question was asked. How pollution of atmosphere from smoke is minimized? 1 mark by smoke precipitation. So what students may have written in the evaluation we have seen. How pollution of atmosphere from smoke should be minimized? Answer written was, people should stop smoking. This was the answer written. That smoke I am not talking. That will not pollute much. Huge amount of factory smoke. This I am talking. Or people of the house, they should not light wood and all. They have to use gas. These are other. This is not essay I am talking, remember. One word. How pollution from smoke is minimized? Smoke precipitation. How? What is the way? Remember, there are electrodes. There are electrodes which are fixed to the positive, negative. Fixed to the chimneys of the factories top, where smoke particles gets coagulated and settles. And even this is having a use. What is that? People are applying for ice and all. Kajal. What is that? Cardigan. Kannada. So for that, this can be used also. So it is having a good application also. That smoke, fine smoke, is precipitated and settles down. And the when the carbon particles are precipitated from the smoke, air goes to the atmosphere. Understand? Yes. So this is called Cottrell's electrostatic precipitator. So this is another application. Next, cleansing action I have already discussed. Cleansing action with the soaps and detergents through micelles. I don't discuss anything. So, associated colloid. Micelles are responsible to how cleansing action is absorbed, also I told you. So, this is another application. So, photography, especially black and white photography. In the photography, it is a digital photography. But in the black and white photography, there is a chemical used, silver bromide. This is photosensitive, AGBR. This is coated on normally glass or something. Photosensitive component is, and it receives the image from the photograph. And the negatives what are used, negatives are called in these words. So that was containing this chemical. And this is by a phenomena of what? The colloidal formations. This is another application. I think tanning of leather industry, etc. Here also, tanning is removal of the hides. So these are all some of the applications of colloids. And I think with this, the chapter on surface chemistry is completed. And remember, with this, physical chemistry is also over. So, what about the next part of our class? So, two chapters in physical inorganic chemistry, 8 hours each, and three chapters in organic. So, we will continue from tomorrow.